When a customer walks into a garden center and asks a salesperson about a difficulty in the garden, the salesperson may not recognize the problem or know the solution. After all, lots of things can be wrong, and none of us can know everything. Sometimes the salesperson will offer a bag of fertilizer. Everybody knows about fertilizer. Shortages of nutrients are not uncommon, and it is easy to apply, so give it a try. Such an unsophisticated approach to plant nutrition and fertilizer is obviously not very professional. Compared to some other characteristics of soil, nutrient status can be modified fairly easily, and fertilization is a standard practice of growing plants. But there is a lot to know about effective management of nutrients without causing environmental damage. I'm Dr. DeBusk, and this video provides details about the macronutrients plants need, starting with nitrogen. Nitrogen, more than any element, promotes rapid growth and dark green color. Plants require more nitrogen than any other mineral element as an essential part of protein and chlorophyll. As the most mobile of mineral nutrients in the environment, readily lost from the soil, it is usually most in need of annual replenishment. Plants respond to nitrogen in the following ways. Nitrogen speeds growth. Plants receiving adequate nitrogen have vigorous growth, large leaves, and long stem internodes. Robust root systems need adequate but not excess nitrogen. Plants make large amounts of chlorophyll, the green pigment that performs photosynthesis. On well-fed plants, leaves are dark green. On poorly fed ones, they are pale green. Plants use water best when they have ample nitrogen. Nitrogen increases utilization of carbohydrates and increases their transformation into protein. Crops are more productive, turf is thicker, greener, and lusher. Plants with too much nitrogen do not grow properly, however. High tissue nitrogen contents cause a very succulent growth, that is, growth that is high in water content but lower in dry matter. This weakens the plant. There are some problems associated with too much nitrogen. Easily injured growth is encouraged. Plant stems are weaker and more easily topple or lodge in rain. Succulent high nitrogen growth is more prone to many insects and diseases. Overly rapid growth slows maturity and ripening of many crops. Overly rapid growth also delays the hardening off process that protects many plants from cold, exposing them to winter damage. For that reason, in cold climates, people are discouraged from applying nitrogen to perennial and woody plants in late summer. In all plants, slow growth and stunting are the most obvious signs of nitrogen shortage. Because nitrogen is part of chlorophyll, nitrogen-deficient plants lack the dark green color of well-fed plants. This symptom is called chlorosis. Because nitrogen is highly mobile in the plant, under conditions of low nitrogen, it is translocated from older to younger leaves to continue growth. This means that older leaves display poor color first. It may progress to being generalized over the whole plant. In grasses, yellowing starts at the blade tips, progresses down the midvein, and finally the entire leaf yellows. In extreme cases, the leaf dries up, a symptom called firing. In broadleaf plants, leaves are small with overall yellowing. Of the essential elements, nitrogen undergoes the most movement and change. The series of gains, losses, and changes is termed the nitrogen cycle. The central portion of the nitrogen cycle operates by the action of soil microorganisms. The complete nitrogen cycle includes some non-biological processes as well, as shown in the figure as broken lines. Two other forms of fixation add usable nitrogen to the soil. First, lightning during storms provides energy to combine gaseous nitrogen and oxygen in the atmosphere to form nitrogen dioxide, NO2. The gas dissolves in water vapor to produce nitric acid, HNO3. About 5 to 10 pounds per acre of nitrogen fall to earth yearly in rain and snow from this source. Second, large amounts of nitrogen are fixed from the air in fertilizer factories and applied to soil by growers. The nitrate ion is negatively charged and so is not absorbed by soil colloids, nor is it held in soil by other means, so nitrates easily leach from the soil. Although ammonia does not leach readily, being absorbed by soil colloids, it too can be lost by a process called ammonia volatilization, as seen in this equation. If soil dries, for instance, water is lost from the right side of the equation. As a result, the reaction shifts to the right and releases ammonia gas. If the soil is made more alkaline, by liming for instance, the reaction again shifts to the right because of an excess of hydroxyl ions. Thus, substantial losses of ammonium nitrogen can occur when ammonium fertilizers or manure are applied to soil, especially if it is alkaline or recently limed. Agricultural land leaks large amounts of nitrogen. Growing crops or even turf lawns changes the balance greatly in ways that increase nitrogen losses. Nitrogen is removed by harvest or removal of grass clippings from a lawn. Nitrogen is often applied heavily in excess of plant needs. This excess will not be taken up by plants and is free to move. Crop soil is more likely to erode, so nitrogen and other nutrients are carried off in running water. Irrigation increases percolation of water through the soil profile, increasing nitrate losses by leaching. At the same time, wetter soil may increase denitrification losses. Liming may increase the loss of ammonia by volatilization. Growers adjust nitrogen levels by fertilizing, by adding organic sources of nitrogen like manure or compost, and by growing legumes. About 97% of soil nitrogen resides in organic matter, the soil's storehouse of nitrogen. At any time, only a small percentage of nitrogen is mineralized to usable forms. On the average, decay makes about 90 pounds of mineral nitrogen per acre per year. It follows that cropping systems that preserve soil organic matter, such as no-till and some organic farming, also retain more soil nitrogen. In one 1996 study, after 23 years of continuous corn, there were 9 milligrams of mineralizable nitrogen per kilogram of soil in the top 7.5 centimeters under no-till, compared to 1.4 milligrams of nitrogen under conventional tillage. Both mineral forms of nitrogen, ammonium and nitrates, are taken in by plants. Ammonium nitrogen bears a positive charge and soil colloids attract the cation, while the nitrate ion is negative and moves freely through the soil and can be lost through leaching or denitrification. Phosphorus also spurs growth, but to a lesser extent than nitrogen. Phosphorus is second only to nitrogen in its importance to plant productivity around the world. However, plants use only about 1/6 of the amount of phosphorus as nitrogen, leading to common overapplication and environmental pollution. Phosphorus affects plant growth in a number of ways. Phosphorus is part of genetic material, chromosomes and genes, and so is involved in plant reproduction and cell division. Phosphorus is part of the chemical that stores and transfers energy in all living things, adenine triphosphate, ATP. Without it, all biological reactions come to a halt. Cell membranes contain large amounts of phosphorus, making it important for cell membrane integrity and function. Phosphorus spurs early and rapid root growth and helps a young plant develop roots. Phosphorus helps plants use water more efficiently by improving water uptake by roots. Phosphorus helps plants resist cold and disease, speeds maturity, aids blooming and fruiting, and improves the quality of grains and fruits. Because phosphorus is needed for root growth, it is often a major element in starter fertilizers, those applied at planting. Phosphorus comes from weathering of soil minerals such as apatite. Most phosphorus is stored in organic matter or fixed forms. At any one time, only a tiny amount of phosphate is in solution and available to plants. Many soils contain large amounts of phosphate, but most is unavailable to plants. Phosphate in insoluble forms that are not free for plant growth is said to be fixed. The reactions that fix phosphate depend on soil pH. In strongly acid soil, pH 3.5 to 4.5, insoluble iron phosphates form. Between pH 4.0 and 6.5, phosphorus reacts with aluminum. Calcium phosphates are important between pH 7.0 and 9.0. Maximum availability lies at pH 6.5 in mineral soils, but 6.0 to 7.0 is satisfactory for most plants. Phosphate ions also become tightly bound to clay particles by replacing the hydroxyl groups in the particle. As plants remove phosphate from solution, mineral and organic phosphate become soluble by mineralization in the activities of phosphorus-dissolving bacteria. Because phosphorus availability is low in so many of the world's soils, plants have developed adaptations to improve access to it. These include mycorrhizal associations, specialized root systems, high root length densities, longer root hairs, and exudates given off by roots and mycorrhizae that free phosphorus. Phosphorus moves very slowly in mineral soil, diffusing over a distance as small as 0.25 inch. Phosphorus does not readily leach downward in soil, as do nitrates. Instead of leaching, phosphorus is more commonly lost by runoff, erosion, or blowing soil. It also increases the difficulty of plants in obtaining adequate phosphorus. Because of low mobility, it is critical that phosphate fertilizer be placed near seed when planted or mixed into soil near roots, such as in the laying of new sod. Uptake of phosphorus depends on a number of soil conditions. Soil pH largely sets the degree of fixation. Phosphorus is most free at a pH of 6.5 to 6.8. Dry soil stalls diffusion of phosphorus to roots. Therefore, roots take up phosphate best in moist soils. Oxygen is needed for the breakdown of organic phosphates. Cold soil slows the activity of microorganisms that place phosphorus in solution, slows diffusion to roots, and retards root growth. Any condition that limits root growth limits ability to forage for phosphorus. Mycorrhizal infection of plant roots helps the plant absorb phosphorus, especially in low phosphorus soils. A shortage of phosphorus can cause stunting and fewer smaller leaves. Plants remain dark green or may even become darker green than normal. Phosphorus deficient plants often have a purple tint to leaves and stems, starting on lower, older leaves. The purpling develops from an increase in the pigments responsible for red plant colors, anthocyanins. Plants that do not synthesize the pigment will not show the color. For some plants, stunting without other obvious symptoms is typical. A phosphorus shortage may delay maturity of several crops, including corn, cotton, soybeans, and others. Some crops, such as carrots, develop poor root systems. On the other hand, excess soil phosphorus ties up several plant nutrients such as iron. Potassium, often called potash, is a key plant nutrient. Plants consume more potassium than any other nutrient except nitrogen. Potassium is dissolved in plant fluids. As a major cell solute, it regulates many functions related to osmosis. These include opening and closing of leaf stomata. Osmotic process related to potassium ions regulate the guard cells, which controls water loss by transpiration and the exchange of oxygen and carbon dioxide with the atmosphere. Low potassium is associated with water stress in plants. Osmotic uptake of water by roots necessary for keeping the plant well supplied with water. This also contributes to water stress in low potassium plants, providing a cell pressure that increases the size of plant cells and thus growth. Potassium is instrumental in moving sugars produced by photosynthesis within the plant, so it is important in ripening of fruits such as apples or tomatoes. Potassium and nitrogen in proper balance stimulate a less succulent growth with greater dry mass. Potassium comes from weathering of minerals such as feldspar. Soil stores potassium by adsorbing it to soil colloids and fixing some in certain clay particles. Potassium moves more readily in soil than does phosphorus, but less readily than nitrogen. Because potassium is held on clay or other colloids, it is least mobile in fine textured soil and is most readily leached from sandy soils. Most plant uptake of potassium occurs by diffusion. Growers see potassium deficiencies less often than those of other primary nutrients. Shortages occur primarily in sandy, heavily leached soils, especially if irrigated or inorganic soils. Overfertilization with nitrogen can cause plant tissues to lack potassium. Plants show a lack of potassium by a marginal scorch or burnt look on the edges of the lower, older leaves. This symptom can be easily mistaken for moisture shortage during hot, dry weather or for salt damage. In some cases, the margins merely turn yellow. Potassium deficiencies can promote lodging in small grains and weak stems in turf grasses. The three secondary elements, calcium, sulfur, and magnesium, are just as important as the primary elements, but are less commonly a problem and less commonly used in fertilizers. Calcium is the nutrient used in the third greatest amount by most plants. Calcium pectate lends strength to cells and glues them together, as in this root hair. Calcium is important for cell wall and membrane integrity as well as holding adjacent cells together. By enhancing the integrity of cell walls and membranes, and also by inducing formation of stress protective proteins in plant cells, calcium increases stress resistance in plants. Calcium also plays a role in protein formation and carbohydrate movement in plants, and plays a signaling or regulatory role in several plant functions, like directing roots to grow down rather than up. It also largely controls soil pH and helps soil aggregation. Weathering releases calcium and magnesium from soil minerals like limestone, dolomite, or gypsum, and stores them on soil colloids. Because of its role in cell walls and membranes, calcium shortages present the greatest problems where cells are actively dividing and enlarging, such as root and shoot tips, and developing fruits. Calcium moves poorly in the plant, tending to be bound to cell walls, and moves entirely via water in the transpiration stream. Organs that receive little water via the transpiration stream, such as developing fruit, are prone to calcium deficiencies. Calcium deficiencies also commonly occur during conditions that reduce transpiration, such as cool, humid, cloudy weather, or the highly humid air that can occur inside a greenhouse. Many horticultural crops commonly experience challenging problems. Most familiar to home gardeners is blossom end rot of tomato and pepper, in which cells at the blossom end of the fruit furthest from the stem, where water, hence calcium, enters the fruit, collapse and rot. Other vexing problems include bitter pit and water core in apples, bract burn in poinsettias, black heart of celery, or leaf burn in lily. Calcium shortages also impair storage of horticultural products. These problems often relate to water stress, and actions to reduce water stress like mulching tomatoes are helpful. In greenhouses, increasing the transpiration rate by reducing humidity and increasing air movement helps. Foliar sprays of calcium chloride or nitrate directly on sensitive tissue is a common solution. Incorporation of gypsum in potting mixes or soil may also reduce problems. Magnesium resembles calcium chemically and in its action in soil. Its role in the plant differs, however. Magnesium is the essential ingredient in chlorophyll. Each molecule has one magnesium atom in its center. Magnesium also aids the uptake of other elements, especially phosphorus. Like potassium, magnesium activates a number of important enzyme systems. Magnesium is involved in protein, carbohydrate, and fat synthesis, as well as a wide range of other compounds. Deficient plants offer less resistance to drought, cold, and disease. Magnesium weathers from minerals as a cation. However, clay holds magnesium less strongly than calcium, so it is more easily leached. As a result, low magnesium soils are more common than low calcium soils. Highly leached coarse soils are most likely to need fertilization with magnesium, especially if treated with low magnesium lime. Sand-based golf greens have a low CEC and are heavily irrigated, so magnesium shortages often lead to poor turf color. Magnesium also leaches readily from greenhouse potting soils, so greenhouses often use high magnesium fertilizers. High levels of soil potassium may also induce a magnesium shortage in plants. Hunger signs result from low levels of chlorophyll. These include intraveinal chlorosis and mottling of older leaves. Plants need less sulfur than other macronutrients, but it is still a crucial nutrient used in large amounts. Several proteins include sulfur, and it is needed for making chlorophyll. It aids nodulation in legumes and seed production of all plants. Overall, sulfur improves protein and chlorophyll content, stress tolerance, animal nutrition, and the appearance of plant products. Alfalfa, members of the mustard family, including cabbage, and members of the onion family need much sulfur. The pungent flavors of those plants derive from sulfur compounds. As opposed to this, the famous Vidalia onions are special varieties grown on low sulfur soils in Georgia to be less pungent. Most soil sulfur comes from the weathering of sulfate minerals such as gypsum, creating a sulfur ion. Acid rain also supplies sulfur in many areas. Organic matter contains 70% to 90% of the soil sulfur. Plants that are short of sulfur may be stunted, and older leaves will be pale green, like those of nitrogen-deficient plants. In conclusion, the macronutrients promote rapid growth in both leaf and root tissue and stress resistance, while being key components to internal cell structures. Most of the nutrients come from weathering of parent materials, except nitrogen, and how they interact with the soil affects their mobility. Deficiencies cause problems with the growth of the plant.